doesn't mind hurting. If you've got him like this, right? So if I get him a little bit onto the foot, and this is just a destruction. But his center is here. If I get his center past the foot, then the foot starts to become leg. So if I do want to sweep the load bearing side, I gotta time it at the point where I'm wide, and then just as he's about to make a compensation step, that's where my sweep is.
Nice.
And then you can go. It's your limit. So you just can tap this. So if I'm leaning like that to bait him, we're turning, we're moving, I step like that. As I step, it's whoop. Just straight down. As soon as he's crossed, just before he wants to step.
Nice. I like it.
That's right.
Do it again.
That's right, or maybe a deep.
Yo, perfect.
If you're, the first step isn't enough, you can go back, but you can also take another step. This goes down.
What's that step called?
Side shuffle. So here's not enough.
Yes. Yes. Like it.
Light. This is about 6 centimeters and pull, right? Yeah. So watch this. If I stay here, I can't pull them far without having to turn it. But if I step forward a little bit, now I can pull all the way back to here, and my foot's blocking. You'll get to that step with the other leg in it.
You make it look so easy.
Stress.
Nice.
Because now you're thinking about it, yeah, you have no choice, you can't, yeah. So it gives it reason. It really teaches you to take the opening that's given rather than choose to always go in. Jam me up, right? So just release it and point and still go the deviation. And if you're here, you stand strongly. Right here, I can't do anything close. But if before I get to that position, I reach, it's good. Here's good. I often grab here. Top. Even if that came here, it wouldn't really change it.
A minute, guys. Last 10 minutes.
Now, guys, admittedly, this is not basic material. This is at minimum intermediate to advanced. It doesn't mean we can't introduce it at earlier levels to let people sort of get a taste of it. Some people can pick it up quite early, but generally, we want to have a good understanding of the fundamentals, level 1 through 4, the baseline, the angulation, the leverage. We want to understand how fulcrums work. We want to understand some sense of the three centers. And then we go into this idea of how all of these elements truly combine when we attach ourselves to another human. What's most important for me going forward is that we understand we do not do work in a vacuum. Most of the time when we teach structure breaking, we see it done in very isolated senses where the subject is standing, they're in a perfect posture, or they're not that resistant, and therefore the center is generally truly within the body. we need to understand that centers of mass are a mathematical approximation, and that they don't physically reside in the body, as many early martial arts believed. The Hara, the Dantian, they're not a source of cosmic energy. They're not somewhere inside the body that can be protected and built. Rather, they're floating. They usually oscillate between the solar and the lunar plexus, up and down the track, but they can be outside of our body. And this is one of the most helpful visualizations in understanding how to turn an opponent. So often I see people struggling because they put all of their energy, all of their force into that subject's body, but it's in the wrong point. They're trying to turn them around from the wrong place, and so their lever gets choked. It's kind of like having a beautiful long shovel and really going all the way down to the palate or the blade of the shovel and ignoring the handle. That's how most people work. Beyond being outside of the body, what matters is that we understand our attachment to the subject changes the location. When we are lightly touching somebody, we can get away with just controlling them. But when they are latched on to us, when they are in any way committed and fused to us, then we become a four-legged table. We become a creature that is merged, and our center is between both of our centers. And this is an essential understanding. This means we need to move that combined center outside of our combined base of sustenance, that big four-legged surface area. I can facilitate this by lifting up one of the legs of the table. If I lift up one of mine, then I'm one-legged, and my opponent now is part with me of a three-legged table. So he's very dependent. I cannot lift up my leg without pulling him down. And likewise, if he lifts up one of his legs, we become even more precariously unbalanced. So we have a huge affectation on one another. If I'm able to take off one limb, he's likely to go and replace that on the ground and use that for support. So an understanding of this will change how we approach creating distance and removing limbs. Most importantly, I think, is this realization that we really need to remember Newton's laws of motion. And if we allow our opponent to stay at rest, they will tend to want to stay at rest. If we simply attack a static subject, they're much, much harder to move. So we want to get them into motion, and they'll tend to stay in motion. We want to take them apart one piece at a time, that victory of inches, little bite after bite, moving and pulling. And again, this goes back to those Japanese ideas of kazushi, testing the grip, testing the balance, looking for the opening. And as we saw, kazushi can also create a freeze, but not a permanent immobile freeze, but a freeze within that motion, which suddenly locks them up and ironically makes them much more prone to your entry. We saw that in the entry phase, the tsukuri, when we try to fit in, that fitting in does not mean taking whatever they give us. It can mean creating the opening that we want, or it can mean adapting in a way where we maintain form. But we should never deform ourselves in a way that we sacrifice our balance in order to pursue breaking their structure. We always want to be stable, strong, and structured. Always, always, always. So keep that center as a visualization. Recognize that it can reside outside of the body, particularly when their posture is deformed defensively, to improve their balance. Realize that we increase dependency on one another when we attach firmly, and that those attachments either need to be faked or taken away, or you know, support off the ground has to be changed. We saw that single footing and toeing them, lifting them up on the toes, is extremely important. That's a very simple way of looking for it. But most of all, recognize that joint center of mass really can only be felt and understood if we keep our opponent in motion. If they are static and fused and we are trying to move around them, it's kind of like trying to turn a rusty valve. It's very, very hard to do. So take them apart one piece at a time, get them moving, put the time in on the mat. Don't rush it. So often we want to go in fully resistant, grappling as hard as we can, but the reality is you're far better off, even if your opponent is super resistant, to protect yourself, play it safe, nice and softly, go one piece at a time. Doesn't matter how spastic your opponent is, protect yourself and keep yourself calm so that you can actualize these changes. If you allow yourself to become infected with the tension and you get stressful, then you're not going to be able to explore new ideas. So no matter how savage and crazy your partner is, you want to always try to stay inside that box and just look at how you can test their balance. And this is how you learn to see openings. This is how you learn to create openings. And most of all, it's how you learn to maximize on those openings. As always, guys, I thank you so much for watching. If you have absolutely any questions, I invite them anytime. And until next time, I look forward to seeing you on the mat.